Hello, and welcome to Replay Value. The first episode of Fate Zero was all about establishing master relationships and character arcs, and hey, I spent 3 videos talking all about that, so it must have been pretty impressive. The second episode is focused on master-servant relationships, 3 specifically, and we'll be doing a lot of compare and contrast again because that's how the entire episode is structured. Spoiler alert, that's how every episode is structured. I talked about the introduction of Castor and his master last time I covered Fate Zero, so give that a watch if you haven't already. Since that'll prep you well for the discussion here, I won't be going through the introduction itself after all. With all of that said, let's destroy some preconceptions and develop some relationships. The first master-servant pair introduced are Waver and Ryder, and they serve as the best example to undercut the understanding that those titles would imply. While Waver very much insists on acting bossy in the opening scene, Ryder's affable personality and the way he agrees with Waver in ways that undermine his bossiness instantly raise questions about who holds the power in their relationship. Ryder is also well positioned to subvert Waver's expectations, as our opening shot is Waver's point of view of the door to the library, and only the loud banging moves the gaze to where Ryder is actually exiting. That kind of subtle decision in shot selection carries on throughout most of their interaction, helping the audience be fully dissuaded from the idea that Waver is the one in charge. As Waver complains about Ryder's attitude, Ryder's mere glare is enough to throw Waver completely off balance, destroying any semblance of control the young mage had in the situation. The mere physicality of the characters and their depiction in frame creates a massive power imbalance. Ryder isn't a bad guy though, just not one to be spoken down to, even as he makes himself more approachable by sitting down, getting on Waver's level. Another story element we're dissuaded from is the idea that servants want nothing more than to win the Grail. As is made clear, since Ryder desires to conquer the entire world, and the Holy Grail War is almost secondary, something that Waver keeps bringing up and Ryder treats like an annoyance. Waver's wish for the Grail is to be treated fairly and for his talents to be respected, which is decried as small by Ryder. After Ryder picks him up and says that he'd be better off asking for more height, Waver is still significantly shorter than him. And in the next shot, we see that Waver's even standing on a small wall, making the true size difference almost night and day. That doesn't stop Waver from looking down on Ryder, still seeing himself as superior as shown in these shots, to convey Waver's feelings of disrespect that in turn introduce us to how command seals work. After Ryder summons his chariot, provoked by Waver questioning his confidence, Waver is again on the ground looking up at Ryder, and nods his head to agree with Ryder's orders, a complete 180 in what the terms themselves would have suggested. There's a conflict here about who's going to be following who, the one who dominates the frame or the one with the title and the ability to force compliance. Compared to Kiritsugu and Saber's relationship though, Waver and Ryder are the greatest team on the planet, as the Einsburn duo can't even speak to each other. We get a quick peek into Kiritsugu's relationship with Ilya, slyly inserting Kiritsugu's view on competition that he's willing to cheat to win, even as it's played as a cute interaction between father and daughter. But the bulk of this conversation is between Saber and Irie, as we learn why Kiritsugu and Saber can't get along. Irie clarifies that it's not because Saber is a woman, but rather that Saber was forced to become king as a young girl, and that she accepted that fate. And in acknowledging that Kiritsugu has no right to judge, as Saber states explicitly, he's chosen to say nothing, leaving us in a position where master and servant will never see eye to eye. Similarly to Ryder, it's not that Kiritsugu is a bad person. The interaction with Ilya at the top and end of the sequence exists not only to foreshadow Irius Veil's fate in the war, and for the sake of bringing out more of the tragic elements for those who experienced Fate Stay Night, but also to humanize Kiritsugu as he's unable to defend himself in Saber's conversation. This sets the groundwork for a conflict in ideals, though they've yet to be clearly stated at this point, that is the center for Kiritsugu and Saber's relationship. But, as Saber says, they'll still fight on the same side because the end goal, the desire to save the world, is something that Saber believes to be just and can agree with Kiritsugu on. As opposed to the Ryder duo, who have entirely different desires and who view their partner's desires as foolhardy, this team, which is far more dysfunctional, doesn't have that same problem. Their problems are in their fundamental disagreement about the nature and role of sacrifice. Kiritsugu is trying to create a world in which no one will have to cry, and for Saber to have willingly accepted such a fate is counter to what he desires. Hold on to that thread, because we'll be developing that one a lot in the future. The entire Kiritsugu-Saber relationship is fascinating for how little screen time they share together. We follow up those two somewhat contentious pairings with the caster pair, who are in complete lockstep as we leave their scene. I've already covered how they grow to realize they're on the same page, but given that the two previous scenes produced arguments, it's another well-executed setup to assume that Caster wasn't going to kill the kid like Ryunosuke wanted, which means that when he does, it maximizes the despair. It's a nice inversion, a team that couldn't agree on the goal, a team that couldn't agree with each other, and now the team that is well put together is the ones who are murderers. Kiritsugu and Saber are partners who can't get along, so the chumminess of Caster and Ryunosuke is an almost sickening reversal bonding over killing as cool. The fact that they get along this early in the game limits the amount of screen time they'll need in comparison to the other two pairings. Which is convenient, as we go to the final scene where Kirei is the only one who seems like a real master bossing around a servant, telling his assassin to attack his mentor's house. But there's not too much to delve into on that pairing, since it's just a quick interaction. It suggests that Kirei isn't someone to be trusted on two levels, as we enter the final scene. My favorite part about the attack on the mansion is that, as Archer says, "Who gave you permission to look up?" the camera pans up from Assassin's point of view. And as though Archer is striking out against the very mechanic of storytelling, fires, cutting the shot off before we can see him. Even after Assassin is dead, Archer says, "You're not worthy to look upon me," and he's covered in shadow. It's all really grandiose and makes the final shot of Archer out to be an unbelievable threat. The second episode lays the groundwork for two of the most interesting pairings in the show and creates clear points of contention not only in their partnerships but with potential opponents. It also sets up the caster duo as an even larger threat since they seem to be one of the only teams that's on the same page. There's more to say regarding Kirei and Assassin in the next episode, but honestly his most interesting servant match is Archer, but of course we'll be getting to that in the far, far future. We'll be picking up a lot of these threads in future episode breakdowns, though I'm tempted to just do a video purely on the Kiritsugu and Saber relationship since there's a lot of things that make sense in retrospect in this opening scene that we won't be getting to for a long time. Let me know whether you'd like me to keep going episode by episode or to switch it up and go thematically, character arcly, battle scenely, etc.ly. Like, subscribe, Twitter, Discord, yada yada, and as always, thanks for watching.